Let's go through the structures that make up the nasal airway and consider the function of each. The nose is really quite an amazing structure. It is our primary airway first and foremost. An opening for air to enter our bodies may seem simple, but there are several critical issues that must be managed. The lungs are fragile, and the nasal airway is the first line of defense against dirty, dry, and cold air. The first task that your nose must accomplish is to provide a rainproof airway. Perfect breathing air should be clean, humid, and warm, like in this forest. Unfortunately, noses also have to cope with dusty, dry desert air. Dry air needs humidification, dusty air needs cleaning, and cold air needs warming. The large surface area of the nasal passage performs these functions. The nasal hairs, called vibrissae, are the first line of defense against large particles and debris. The external part of the nose has to be somewhat flexible to bounce back from trauma, yet rigid enough to maintain an opening. As air flows into the nostrils, the flow creates an inward force that tends to collapse the nostril. Flexible cartilage under the nasal skin provides support to resist this force. The paired lower lateral cartilages and upper lateral cartilages are embedded in the nasal skin and provide this support. The paired lower lateral cartilages are the primary support for the nostril as viewed from the front. Once air enters the nose, it is divided into the left and right by the nasal septum. The septum extends from the nostrils to the nasopharynx. The septum provides additional surface area for air to come in contact with mucous membranes. The septum changes the airway into more of a slot on each side, as the yellow cross section demonstrates. This shape encourages laminar airflow, which has lower resistance than if there is turbulent airflow. The anterior portion of the septum is composed of cartilage that can flex and move without breaking. The superior septum is comprised of thin bone, which is a component of the ethmoid bone. The inferior and posterior part of the nasal septum is the thick vomer bone, a distinct bone that abuts the skull base at the sphenoid bone. The farthest back portion of the nasal airway does not have a partition. The nasopharynx is this common space and represents the back of the nasal airway and the top of the pharynx. The inferior turbinate is a large and important part of the nasal airway. It runs from the front of the nose to the back. The inferior turbinate is a discrete skull bone and attaches to the maxillary bone. The inferior turbinate is a highly vascular structure and can change size to regulate airflow. It has a large surface area to humidify and warm the air. The space under the inferior turbinate is called the inferior meatus. Another discrete bone, the lacrimal bone, shown in green, helps form the tear duct, which drains into the inferior meatus. The middle and superior turbinates are part of the ethmoid bone. The middle turbinate serves as a key landmark during sinus surgery and diagnostic endoscopic examinations. The middle turbinate acts as an awning for the sinus drainage from the frontal sinus, the anterior ethmoid sinuses, and the maxillary sinus. The middle turbinate is often divided into three sections, the vertical portion, the basal lamella, and the horizontal portion. The basal lamella divides the anterior ethmoid sinuses from the posterior ethmoid sinuses. The posterior ethmoid sinuses drain from under the superior turbinate. Airflow through the slot-shaped passage between the septum and the turbinates can be divided into three levels. Most of the airflow occurs low in the nasal passage between the septum and the inferior turbinate. The highly vascular inferior turbinate can change size and regulate airflow at this level. The left and right inferior turbinates alternate between enlarging and shrinking, allowing one side at a time to recover from dry or irritating air exposure. The second level is between the middle turbinate and the septum. The middle turbinate does not change size like the inferior turbinate. A vascular location of the septum called the swell helps to regulate airflow at this level. The swell can change in size similar to the inferior turbinate. The third level of airflow is high in the nasal cavity. This extremely narrow passage leads to the olfactory nerve endings where the sense of smell begins. This region does not have a large airflow volume. The delicate nerve endings require slow-moving, clean, well-humidified air to function at their best. The uncinate process is a component of the ethmoid bone. There are several different configurations of the uncinate. The uncinate process provides a gutter to direct drainage from the maxillary sinus, and depending on the exact shape, it can also channel drainage from the frontal sinuses and some of the anterior ethmoid sinuses. The uncinate process helps to protect the maxillary sinus opening from direct airflow and possible contamination. You may have heard of the ostiomeatal complex. Ostia means opening, and the meatus is the space under the middle turbinate. The arrangement of the maxillary sinus opening, the uncinate process, the ethmoid bulla, the ethmoidal infundibulum, the hiatus semilunaris, and the passage from under the middle turbinate define the entity. The ostiomeatal complex is not a specific anatomic structure, but instead, this term describes the overall configuration of this critical drainage intersection. The infundibulum is a key space related to the ostiomeatal complex. The infundibulum is that space that is bordered medially by the uncinate process, laterally by the lamina papyracea, which is the thin bone that makes up the orbital cavity here, and posteriorly by the ethmoid bulla. Its shape has been compared to the shape of a wedge of citrus fruit. Another named space is the hiatus semilunaris. This term describes a space for drainage that is between the free margin of the uncinate process and the anterior face of the ethmoid bulla. The hiatus semilunaris is the two-dimensional passage between these structures. The nasal cavity and sinuses are lined with mucous membranes. They are called mucous membranes because they secrete mucus. It is thought that the nose makes about a quart of mucus each day. The constant flow acts as a self-cleaning mechanism. Dust particles, pollen, and bacteria that lodge on the viscous mucus are swept posteriorly by the flow and swallowed throughout the day. When all systems and drainage routes are working correctly, bacteria are moved along before they can replicate or cause infection. Irritating pollens are moved along to reducing their effect on the membranes, and dust and dirt are prevented from accumulating. Unlike this simulation, healthy nasal mucus is produced by all of the surfaces, and it flows in an extremely thin, clear layer directed towards the throat for swallowing. The mucous membranes have hair-like cilia on their surface, which provides the pumping action that makes active mucus flow possible. Particles stick in the viscous mucus and are moved along by the coordinated action of the cells that line the sinuses, much like a drunken crowd surfer is moved at a concert. The drainage from the anterior sinus cavities mix together in the ostiomeatal region. The frontal sinus drainage is shown in green. It mixes with the maxillary sinus drainage as it passes over the uncinate process. The anterior ethmoid sinus drainage is shown in blue. The combination of these three drainage sources is shown in red. The posterior ethmoid sinus drainage is shown in purple, and the sphenoid sinus drainage is shown in yellow. As you can see, the nasal cavity is well equipped to provide a low-resistance airway and condition the air as it passes into the lungs.